Hello everybody, this is Dr. Tani Issa, Professor of Pathology. I make these videos for all medical students. Hope someone may find it helpful. We are going to start from the beginning. Chapter 1, Cellular Responses to Stress and Toxic Insults, Adaptation, Injury, and Cell Death. So this is introduction to pathology. So what is pathology? Pathology comes from two Greek words, logos and patho. Pathos means suffering, and logos means to study. So roughly you can say that pathology is the study of suffering or the study of disease. So you can say that pathology is the science concerned with the study of disease. This is Rudolf Virchow. Rudolf Virchow was a German pathologist, anthropologist, and biologist. And he was the first one to say that all forms of disease start with molecular or structural alterations in cells. And that's why he was called the father of modern pathology, because he was the first one to say that all diseases start with just molecular or structural alteration in the cells. So scientifically, you can define pathology as disease as the study of the structural, biochemical, and functional changes in cells, tissues, and organs that underlie diseases. So how we are going to study pathology, how we are going to study diseases? We are going to study diseases by the use of molecular, microbiologic, immunologic, and morphologic techniques. Pathology provides an understanding of the disease process, their causes, their morphology, and their clinical effects. And according to this understanding, pathology gives a scientific basis for accurate diagnosis and treatment. So pathology serves as a bridge between the basic science and the clinical medicine. And it is the scientific foundation for all of medicine. Traditionally, the study of pathology is divided into general pathology and systemic pathology. So go to general pathology. And general pathology is concerned with the basic reactions of the cells. So general pathology concerned with the basic reactions of the cells and the tissues to abnormal stimuli, and also the inherited defects, which are the main causes of disease. So in general pathology, you are going to study the basic reactions of the cells to injury, to stress, to injury, cell death, types of cell death. You are going to study inflammation. You are going to study the genetic diseases. You are going to study inflammation and healing and genetic diseases and all the basic reactions of the cells. General pathology examines the alterations in specialized organs and tissues that are responsible for disorders that involve these organs. So in systemic pathology, you are going to study the diseases which occur in each system. You are going to study diseases of respiratory system, diseases of cardiovascular system, diseases of gastrointestinal system, diseases of urinary system, and so on. So what is the core of pathology? The core of pathology, number one, etiology, the cause. What is the cause of the disease? How to study disease? You should know the cause of the disease. And we call this etiology. Then you have to know the pathogenesis. What is pathogenesis? Pathogenesis is the mechanisms of its development. And then you have to know the morphology and the molecular changes of the cells and tissues. And then you have to see the biochemical structural alteration induced in the cells and organs of the body. And then you have to know the clinical manifestations or and functional consequences, clinical manifestations of each disease. So the core of pathology is etiology, which means its cause, pathogenesis, mechanisms of development, then molecular and morphologic changes, and clinical manifestation. Let's start with etiology. Etiology is the cause of the disease. The cause may be genetic or acquired. And genetic may be inherited. Genetic means inherited. Genetic means inherited diseases. So example, inherited mutations and disease associated gene variants. You are going to study genetics, hereditary diseases. You are going to study a whole chapter of genetic diseases. And to study any disease, you have to know if it is genetic or it is acquired. Acquired diseases usually infectious, nutritional, or degenerative. So most of acquired diseases are either due to infection, whether due to viral, bacterial, fungal, or any infections, or nutritional imbalance, or degenerative diseases. Most of the diseases are in this category, infectious, nutritional, degenerative, or tumors. Or multifactorial. So you have genetic diseases, you have acquired diseases, and you have some diseases which are multifactorial. In multifactorial, we don't know the exact cause of the disease. We don't know what is the exact cause, but we know some risk factors. So in these cases, like atherosclerosis, for example, we don't know the exact cause of atherosclerosis, but we know some risk factors that may lead to the development of atherosclerosis. So in multifactorial diseases, we know the risk factors, and this is called external triggers. And these external triggers act on a genetically susceptible individual. And the contribution of the genetic part and the contribution of the external triggers differ from one disease to another and from one person to another. So what is pathogenesis? Pathogenesis is the sequence of events from the initial stimulus to the ultimate expression of the disease. This means the mechanisms, the sequence of events from the initial stimulus till the ultimate expression of the disease. All the mechanisms involved in this way. Number three, molecular and morphologic changes. Morphologic changes refer to the structural alteration in the cells or tissues that are either characteristic of the disease. You may see the changes in the tissues and the organs characteristic of this disease, or diagnostic of its etiologic process. Sometimes when I examine a tissue, I find the TB bacilli. So in this case, this disease is tuberculosis. If during examination of the specimen you see the Bilharzia ova, you know this is Bilharzia lesion, and so on. So the tissue or the examination, morphologic examination, may give you the diagnosis of the disease, or it may give you something which is characteristic of this disease. So how are we going to study the molecular and the morphologic changes? Morphologic changes, to study the morphologic changes, we have to study the gross appearance of the disease, of the lesion. Gross picture means the naked eye appearance or naked eye examination. To examine the lesion by your naked eye, this we call gross examination. Then we see the lesion microscopically, and this is called microscopic examination. We may also use immunologic stains, for example, to see the lesion, or immunologic assay. So immunologic study is also needed. And sometimes radiologic examination is very important, particularly in bone lesions and in chest infections or chest lesions. So radiologic examination sometimes is as important as gross examination. And in bone lesions, radiologic examination is what we have. You don't have the gross lesion, but you have only the radiologic examination. Molecular analysis is very important. So you are going to study gross or naked eye examination of the lesion, then microscopic examination, immunologic and radiologic examination. About molecular, here's morphologic examination. This is gross pathology of fatty change of the liver. And you can see the liver is enlarged, yellow in color, soft, yellow because the color of fat is yellow. This is what you are going to examine the lesion by the naked eye, and this we call gross examination. And then you are going to examine it microscopically under the microscope. And here you can see the liver cells, and the liver cells show vacuoles. These vacuoles represent the fat which was accumulated in the liver cells, and the fat dissolved during preparation, and it gives these vacuoles. So this is gross and microscopic examination. This is aortic valve, and here is the semilunar cusps. You can see the cusps are thick and fibrotic, and you can see here calcification. These humps or these irregular masses, which is piled up irregular masses, these are calcification. So this is dystrophic calcification in aortic valve. Then you can see also here, I'm sorry, here's a lymph node, tuberculous lymph node. This is tuberculosis in a lymph node C. Here is the patient. This is lymph node enlargement in his neck. And here is the lymph node, the gross examination of the lymph node. And this is the microscopic examination. Here is a uterus, which is enlarged. And here you can see these circumscribed masses. And this appears to be benign tumor called leiomyoma. And this is the microscopic examination of the lesion. This is gamma, syphilitic gamma, or in cases of congenital syphilis. This is in the heart. So this is brain. This is brain, and here you can see the brain is not a normal brain, because you can see here widening of the sulci, the narrowing of the gyri and widening of the sulci. See, the sulci are very widened, particularly in the frontal and parietal regions of the brain, and this is Alzheimer's disease. Molecular changes. Molecular analysis by techniques such as DNA microarray reveals genetic differences that predict the behavior of the tumor. We need it very much, because we need to know the behavior of tumors as well as the responsiveness to different therapy. So it is very important, molecular DNA. Go to clinical manifestation. Clinical manifestations include symptoms and signs. What is symptoms and what is signs? Symptoms is what the patient complains. If he complains of distension or drowsiness or cough, these all symptoms. And the signs is what you see on the patient. If the patient is complaining of pain, this is a symptom. If he is complaining of rash, this is a sign. You can see it. See here, this is weakness. The patient is complaining of weakness, shortness of breath, rapid pain. This is all symptoms. These all symptoms. Pain in the stomach, this is symptoms. Cough, symptoms. But if you see rash like this, this is sign. This is, so symptom is what the patient complain of, and sign is what the doctor see on the patient. So rash is a sign. Symptom is what the patient complain of. Sign is what the doctor see on the patient. So rash is a sign. Here also you can see this tooth here, the patient teeth, Hutchinson's teeth. This occur in cases of congenital syphilis. You can see this notch in the teeth, and this is sign. And here you can see the nose, this is called the saddle nose. This is sign. So you have to know clinical manifestation, you have to know the symptoms and the signs of each disease, and then the course of the disease. Some diseases take a short course, like, for example, pneumonia, it takes 2 to 3 weeks, maximum 1 month. But some diseases take a long course, like rheumatoid arthritis, for example. So some diseases take short course and it ends. Some diseases take a long course, like rheumatoid, for example, and it has remissions and relapses. And like ulcerative colitis, for example, it takes a long course, and with remissions and relapses, it comes and goes. Some diseases have complications. You have to know the complications which may occur in each disease. For example, inflammations or lesions of the lungs or affection of the lungs may lead to right-sided heart failure. Some disease, hypertension, may give a complication in the brain or in the heart. So each disease has some complications you have to know. Then you have to know the outcome or prognosis of the disease. For example, pneumonia, you said it's a good prognosis. Bacterial pneumonia is of better prognosis than viral pneumonia, for example. And the benign tumors of better prognosis than malignant tumors. And some malignant tumors are of better prognosis than other malignant tumors. So you have to know the prognosis or the outcome of the disease. And the causes of death, if any, you have, sometimes you know that this patient has perianeurysm and this may rupture at any time. So you may expect that the cause of death may be rupture of this aneurysm. Sometimes you know that this patient have a very high blood pressure and can expect the causes of death, and so on. And you can expect or suggest the line of treatment or to guide in the line of treatment. You can say that this needs medical treatment. If you see the lesion is only mild colitis, for example, or you can see it just inflammation, you can see that this needs medical treatment. But if you have tumor, if the lesion appears to be a tumor, this needs surgery. So you are going to say that needs surgery. And sometimes you can suggest this tumor may need chemotherapy. Some tumors are very sensitive to chemotherapy, like choriocarcinoma is very sensitive to chemotherapy. Other tumors are very sensitive to radiotherapy, like seminoma is very sensitive to radiotherapy. So you will suggest radiotherapy. Some tumors need a combination of these, like breast carcinoma, for example. So you may suggest the line of treatment. Thank you so much.